waiting for the cue. We ready? Okay, good afternoon. How's everybody? Good? I'm Jim Phillips, the Director of Athletics and Recreation here at Northwestern. Welcome to today's panel discussion titled Beyond the Box Score, covering college sports in 2012 and beyond, a part of Medill's Gertrude and G.D. Crane Jr. Lecture Series and co-sponsored by Northwestern Department of Athletics and Recreation. Before I get started, I want to ask a question. Who was at the basketball game last night? Raise your hand. Okay. Who didn't sleep very well last night after the basketball game? So as a sleep-deprived athletic director, I torture myself and watch the game again. So I have to TiVo it and watch it again. So then what do you have to do at 2:30 in the morning? You just get on the internet probably and you start to look up, you know, what's the daily stories and all the rest. And then I found hope, because today's date, February 22nd, 32 years ago, what happened? Anybody? Say it. Who was it? Miracle on Ice. I went right to bed. Felt really good. But anyways, get back to see the Cats next Wednesday against Ohio State and cheer those young men on, because the season's far from over. But today, what a spectacular panel we have here at Northwestern, and it's my pleasure to introduce the panelists. First, Stewart Mandel, senior writer for Sports Illustrated website, SI.com, where he has worked since 1999 covering the national college football beat and college basketball. Mandel's first book, Bowls, Poles, Tattered Souls, Tackling the Chaos and Controversy that reign over college football. If you have not read that, you have to get that book. Outstanding. It was published in 2007. Native of Cincinnati, Ohio, and graduated from Medill in 1998. Married in May, right?
Yes.
Of 11? How about a round of applause for Stewart Mandel? The honeymoon's almost over. Pete Thamel is in his ninth year as college sports reporter for the New York Times. He covers the national college football and basketball beats and has reported stories everywhere from Maui to Istanbul to Beijing. In 2006, the New York Times nominated Thamel for a Pulitzer Prize for national reporting for his work uncovering diploma mills that were giving fast and easy grades to talented high school prospects. He is from Ware, Massachusetts, and graduated from the Big Orange, Syracuse University, in 1999. How about a round of applause for Pete Thamel? Pat Fitzgerald recently completed his sixth season as head coach of Northwestern University's football team. Born and raised in Orland Park, Fitz graduated from Northwestern in 1997. He has guided the Cats to four consecutive postseason berths and five straight years of bowl eligibility, both school records. As a student athlete, Fitz led us to back-to-back Big Ten titles in the mid-90s and was a two-time winner of the Bronco Nagurski and Chuck Bednarik Awards as the nation's best defensive player. He was inducted into the College Football Hall of Fame in 2008. Let's welcome Pat Fitzgerald. Last but not least, today's moderator, Rachel Nichols, originally from Potomac, Maryland, who joined ESPN in February of 2004 as a New York City-based reporter covering breaking news stories and major events, as well as providing investigative pieces and human interest features. In addition to her role on SportsCenter, Nichols provides weekly NFL features and reports for ESPN's studio programs and has regular coverage of the NBA, which she'll tell you after today's event. She's running no hair because she's going to cover the Knicks and the Heat down in Miami. Also a correspondent for E60, ESPN's first multi-themed primetime news magazine, a sideline reporter for Monday Night Football, and an occasional contributor to the sports reporters on Sunday mornings. Rachel graduated from Medill in 1995. One quick story. Wildcat Insider is a weekly show that we do here at Northwestern that covers all of our sports teams. And we had the fortunate privilege of having Rachel as one of our guests. And this was before the Packers and Giants game. and got her at Lambeau Field and asked her, so bottom line, who wins that game? What'd she say? The Giants. And the Giants go on to win the Super Bowl. So if anything doesn't work out in broadcasting prognostications, right there.
Excellent.
I'll turn it over to you, Rachel.
Well, thank you so much. Really appreciate it. Round of applause for Jim. Now, before we start for real, Pat, I do have to say, when you and I were here at school together, I don't remember any girls walking around with their face on their T-shirt the way there are now.
That was probably a good thing.
Well, the bowl stuff is good, but you've come a long way, so I just want to.
It's humbling, but I think you can get a better T-shirt than that.
That's pretty good. We're going to talk about a lot of topics with college sports. We're going to talk a little bit here, and then we're going to take some questions from you guys. Because I will forget by the time we get to that point in the segment. I want to say now, wait for the microphone to come to you, but we'll get to that later. I do want to talk to you guys about a whole bunch of things. We were just talking upstairs, and there seems to be no better topic to start with than social media, especially since it's been a little bit in the news here at Northwestern because of Pat Fitzgerald. So since you should tell your story as opposed to having any of us media clowns tell your story, why don't you tell us sort of what happened and what you learned from that experience?
I wouldn't describe you guys as clowns. I would
not in public.
Right, Teddy? it's funny. You know, I'm very privileged, obviously, to have the role that I have, and I feel that way. And so through that, I get some really special opportunities. So last week, the week after signing day, to make it simple, I take my family on a family vacation, and I let our staff do the same thing. So we had a wonderful night. My wife and I, we tuck our boys into bed. And the next morning, I get an email. Coach, I sent out a tweet accidentally on your account. I apologize for that. Just FYI. Okay, what'd you say? Okay, well, don't worry about it. Thanks, man. Have a great day. 48 hours later, I'm a racist. So, I say that term without laughing for a reason, because obviously I think that that's an epidemic. I think that that's a disease. I think that's a very strong statement to make about any individual regarding anything, and I think that by anybody making that, I think it's a defamation of my character. But I am responsible for what goes on and what's said from me and by me, and if I would have said it, I'd take responsibility for it. If it would have been rooted in that, I would have taken responsibility for it, whether or not I said it or not. But what happens is that gets taken out of context, and then gets questioned. And I understand that's what may happen. But as I have alluded to with many people that I respect and I trust in the media world, I think what's happened over time now and through social media is what gets blogged on, is it fact, is it innuendo? And then what gets blogged on in the messages afterwards, is that a fan, which of course is short for fanatic, or is it fact? And again, now we start to make very strong statements that no one's accountable for. And so I what have I learned from it? Well, number one is I think if someone that is allowed to have an opinion because people listen, I think you have to be as respectful of others through your opinion as you are from what other people say. And I think it's very easy to draw conclusions. I think it's very easy because we are so inundated with information today. It's the same thing that I have to do to teach a 7-year-old little boy named Jack, who's my son, that has access to the internet. You know, just because you read it on the internet doesn't mean that it's fact, or doesn't mean that's what somebody's all about. So I don't want to belabor the point, but, you know, if I could, I'd sue somebody. If I could, I would, but that's not who I am. And it's sad when I see some people I really respect in mainstream media, but, you know, somebody would ask me, well, why didn't you respond to it? Well, if I respond to everything that I get seen or heard or emailed to me that's blogged, I can't coach a football team and I can't raise a family. But if it's blogged by somebody that I respect in a reputable organization, I'm going to respond to it because they are accountable beyond what they say to someone else. And so I think it's a really slippery slope, and I think it's tough for fans. I really do. I think it's really tough for fans because what maybe I said privately is now shared internationally, worldly. And if you don't put your name on there, you're really not putting yourself out there. You're just putting your opinion. You're not accountable to anything, not even yourself. And then on top of that, I get the privilege to coach 110 great young men. And you used to be able to say, hey, listen, we're in a downturn here. We've got to circle the wagon, so to speak. Don't read the newspaper. Everybody's going to be blasting you. Don't listen to what's going on. Now it's like, shut everything off. crawl under a rock? You know, that's not reality. So I think it's a really difficult time, and I think it's a really difficult time for our society. And that's just one simple example. So, you know, I think it's just a one small thing. I mean, there's no bigger Chicago fan than me. I mean, I'm a ridiculous Chicago fan. But now maybe there's some Chicagoans that think I'm not that way. I can't control that, and I'm not going to worry about that. And if that's what you think, it's not my fault. That's your fault. Too bad for you. And so maybe that's arrogance. I don't care. But I know what I believe in. I know what I stand for, and I also know who I root for. And I'm not a Cub hater, all right, for the record.
I mean, have you guys seen this too? Because you guys have blogs, you guys have columns that go on the web, and the differentiation between what you're doing, what fan blogs are doing, how coaches respond to you, those lines are getting blurred a lot more than they ever have been before.
Well, I think what happened to Pat is a perfect illustration of a frustration I'm sure we both have, which is, you know, the good and the bad of Twitter. The good is that it is a good thing that it has leveled the playing field, if you will, and it gives opportunities for young journalists, people who don't have the form of Sports Illustrated or the New York Times, who do good work, to have that work get seen. You know, some of the best reporting on the Penn State situation was done by Sarah Gannum, a 24-year-old reporter for the Harrisburg paper. That never would have been seen by a mass audience before Twitter. But on the flip side, anybody with a blog, anybody with a computer or with an internet connection can put stuff out there, and it's getting harder and harder for the average fan to discriminate. You know, we would like to think that they view Sports Illustrated and the New York Times with a certain level of credibility, and therefore, as representatives of that, they view us as more credible. But as I found during many stories, during the Penn State story, during conference expansion, anything that anyone puts out there, whether it's completely verified or complete rumor, people run with it, and it becomes a story. And I think that's what happened there. You know, somebody saw an opportunity to make a story out of something that, quite frankly, wasn't a story. And then, you know, mainstream media sees that, and they pick up on that, and it becomes a firestorm. And it's impossible to keep up with it. Every day, all day, you would drive yourself nuts if you were trying to chase down every little, you know, on Twitter, hashtag, whatever, you know. Is it true that, you know, San Diego State is going to this conference, that this is happening, that this recruit, you know, broke this rule? You know, it's 95% ends up being nothing. But on Twitter, it gets magnified, and I just think it's got to be really confusing for the average consumer now.
I think to piggyback on what Pat and Stu said, it's a forum for a lot of people to yell louder, to be snarkier, to be funnier. So something's out there, and then it's almost like a competitive situation where people want to make the joke and people want to build it further. And it also allows speculation to almost become fact, because you bandy about a notion of maybe a school going somewhere, maybe a recruit going somewhere, and then it's talked about as fact, and then it's out there as fact, and it gets, you know, it blurs the line between what is news and what is speculation. And I think that's one of the hard things, you know, for a football program to wrestle with, or even for media organizations to wrestle with, because you can report that, you know, I reported today that Temple is in discussions with the Big East. Well, 10 minutes later, it's like, well, Temple's in the Big East, and they're going to do this. And then it's like, well, no, that's actually not what it said. It said this. And it just really, everything just moves so much faster. I would say, you know, Twitter's been probably around for 2 years, maybe. And in that, the news media cycle has sped up, is just to a pace. I don't know if it could speed up anymore.
I went on Twitter to look at all of you, us. Pat, you have around 1,400 tweets to your account, which maybe not all of them you wrote, as we've learned.
I promise you I did not write all of them.
I have about 4,200 tweets. Pete, you've got about 8,300 tweets. Stu, you've got about 13,000 tweets.
You know, so, I gotta try to win something, you know?
Right. Other than learning that Stu has a little bit too much time on his hands, it does show the good side of Twitter, too, and the good side of social media, Facebook, things like that, because, you know, when I'm covering some of these athletes, and you guys are dealing, you know, we're trying to get into the world that you have, Pat, and we're trying to give viewers and readers and fans just as close an experience as possible. And so having the athletes themselves communicate directly with the public, give us a little bit of the insight into, you know, the New York Giants on the team plane, a couple of the guys on the way home from the Super Bowl posted videos of them on the team plane celebrating the Super Bowl. And it's fine if you're a Giants fan to feel like, hey, I'm celebrating along with the team. We just won the Super Bowl, that kind of feel to it. It has both sides, and I'm curious sort of how you use Twitter and Facebook in the good way. The media, obviously, we get that extra exposure, but I bet for you, too, it's a valuable tool.
Well, there's no question. I, you know, for a standpoint of recruiting, it's critically important, especially not only with Twitter, but obviously Facebook. You know, when you think about how email was once mainstream, now it's almost just a business correspondence. It's not a way that you recruit. You know, young men are on Facebook, and that's where they're at, and that's where they live. And, you know, I was at our basketball game last night, and there were some kids all around us, and they never got off their phone. You know, it's like, the game's over there, not here, you know, it's like right there. You know, so it's just changed. It's a great way to start and build a relation, start a relationship, but to build a relationship is human interaction. And I think sometimes we're losing that a little bit, where there's almost this illusion of grandeur by this relationship that's built online. And then you really talk to a young person, and they come to see, and they, again, where's the fact? We're way too much in the gray for a young person, and it's occupying a lot of their time. But it is a great way to at least get that open line of communication, or at least an initial line of communication to get it started. And then a great way, once you know, let's remove from a student-athlete standpoint, let's now move into selling your program to your fans, selling your program, out there to hopefully new fans by just really selling the message. And you have total control of that, you know, from a standpoint of what you try to put out there.
Do you guys all think that in the college ranks that coaches should be able to say to their players, you guys can be on Twitter, you guys can't be on Twitter, let's not be on Facebook this week? Do you think that it's okay for coaches to control that with student-athletes, or do you think that they should have free rein?
It's tricky, because I think Twitter is building, and it's only going to become more and more part of, I think in a journalism world, which I imagine most of you are, it's very common to be on Twitter. I don't know if, I think only 1% of America checks Twitter every day. So we're a little bit skewed in how we view it. But my personal opinion is that a coach limiting his players from going on Twitter and interacting people just hurts them, because it's a communication skill at the end of the day. But I can very much understand, and I don't know if Fitz has any nuances to the rules of that, where you would not want your players to tweet, oh yeah, we worked on a double reverse option today. We're gonna fake a punt against Michigan. Like, you know, if you don't, one coach told me, he's like, I let my guys go there, nothing inappropriate, and then nothing related specifically to our program.
Exactly. You know? Yeah, no, that's exactly it. And, you know, you just don't put anything out there that you wouldn't want your mother to read at the kitchen table. You know, if you use that as a rule of thumb, you're going to probably be in a good position.
What if your mother really likes fake punts?
Well, don't do that. But then you go to the next step and you talk about football. But here's where, you know, as an educator, you have to really try to do the best job of giving all the positives and negatives, the things that you can use to your advantage, and then the areas where it can be a pitfall. And it's just where we're at right now with the internet. I'll go back to when I was a student athlete. If you made a mistake, the coach found out about it, you came in at 5 a.m, you read the stadium steps for a week, you moved on, and it was over. You make a mistake right now, not only does it impact you currently, it embarrasses your program currently, it also goes out there, it's viral, and it lives with you forever. So there's an example out there, unfortunately, for some kids that might be that are wrapped up in drugs right now. So now that happened when I made a bad mistake in college, okay? It's going to follow me to my first job interview, and it's going to follow me when I'm a father, and I have to look across my son or daughter and say, Daddy, when you were in college, you were called a drug dealer. Why? And when I was a kid, that didn't happen. And so that there's the ultimate pitfall. Hey, what happened to me? That's no big deal. You know, that's a misunderstanding. Well, that's not a big deal. But for let's go back to now 14, or maybe even beyond, maybe even younger. I don't know how young it's going to go. The choices and decisions they make are going to live with them forever, and it's going to cost them opportunities by making one bad choice. And that's the concern that I have as an educator, that kids cannot make mistakes now. The minute you make a mistake, you're vilified, and you don't have an opportunity as an educator, in my role as a father, to be able to use that as a teachable and learnable moment and say, look, let's learn from this and let's move on. And I think that's lost now because of all this. I don't know if that's good or bad, but that's where we're at. And that's tough. That's a societal issue.
All right, so now, since this panel is about media covering sports beyond the box score, I'm going to use this as a forum to get out some differing perspectives here. So what is your biggest gripe about covering coaches? Let them have it.
I think that writers have, you know, understand that there's, you know, you can't just, no coach is going to just open the door and give you free rein to the program and, you know, everything like that. But increasingly, we're running into, you know, I would say the number of places where you can actually go and watch practice is dwindling by the year. I mean, And you might say, well, what's the big deal about that? Well, you know, that's how, as a writer, that's how you gain knowledge about the program. I mean, that's how you write, you know, if you want to properly convey to an audience, you know, what's Oregon going to look like this year? What's, you know, how's the new coach, you know, fitting in at Michigan or something like that? You can't get that from just sitting in a conference room doing an interview. Probably coach has done 10 interviews like that already. Now, I understand, you know, we talked about this yesterday, that once you do open that door to practice, you're running the risk that some reporter who doesn't have that kind of trust or relationship is going to go tweet that, you know,
fake pun,
or something, you know, they moved this guy to this position, and something that they, that's, you know, going to hurt the team. So I understand that, but it's just a shame that, you know, I think if you were to go back and look at the coverage of college football from other decades, there'd be, you know, especially in Sports Illustrated, there was so much color, there was so much detail, because the writers basically had free rein. You know, they trusted that if you're here representing Sports Illustrated, this is a good thing for the program, and we're going to let you do what you need to. And now, you know, I won't call out any individual programs, but there's programs, if you go down there, you're going to, they literally like put you in a room with no windows and hand you the stats from the scrimmage at the end, and you go, you could have made these stats up. I mean, who was there to see that these things occurred? So I think that's a real shame. I understand the concerns that they have, I do, but I think that's a real shame for the writers and, more importantly, for the readers.
What about you, Pete?
I think one of the things that as the media has evolved, like with Twitter, so, you know, Fitz has a luncheon on Monday and he says, you know, his quarterback's hurt, or, you know, the news, that used to be what we used to write in the newspaper. We used to write, oh, Northwestern's quarterback is out, their, you know, receiver's back, et cetera. Well, that's become irrelevant because it's news still and people want to read it, but that information gets disseminated so quick. The value for someone who does my job or does Stewart's job is access, and Stewart is head on. So now the access used to be you just used to get to interview the players and coaches. The interesting thing, I think, in the evolution of media, and one of my big pet peeves as we've gone on here, is that the access has gone to the cheerleaders, the guys who maybe, and I don't want to call out like rival scout, whoever, every program has friendly media involved, and that media gets the scoops on when recruits commit. That media gets access to practice, because it makes sense from a philosophical standpoint. If you're a coach or an athletic director, do you want the guy who's going to play it down the middle, who, you know, especially if you're 4-5 and struggling for a bowl, or do you want the reporter in there who at the end of the day wants the team to win, that went to school there, or who owns a website who will make money off of more people hitting? So presumably, if the team wins, then your website's going to do better, and you get more hits and more interest, et cetera. And the shift to me from the, you know, mainstream media to that, I don't even know like a good term for it, because I don't want to demean them, because they work hard and they make phone calls and, you know, they do that. But that has been probably the most interesting shift to me the past 5 years. When you go to these schools, especially the really hotly covered ones in the SEC and a little bit in Big 12 country, they have multiple people who work for just very specific websites that all they do is cover recruiting, and all they do is cover, you know, that team and that practice that day. And over the years, you've seen a shift towards the people who are friendlier to the programs get better access and the chance to write more stories. And that, to me, is a little bit of a disturbing trend, because that's sort of antithetical to the mission of the media. It's so, you almost might as well let the, you know, the dance team or the, you know, the guy in the student section write the story who's cheering, because, you know, that, you know what kind of coverage you're going to get.
And Fitz, you've talked about some of the issues that coaches have with bloggers and sort of that outer group of media. But what about the media from guys like Sports Illustrated, New York Times, or some of the other big outlets, Chicago Tribune? How could that relationship be improved from your end, from the coach's end?
Yeah, I'm not sure it can be. I'm not sure it needs to be improved. I don't feel that, and I don't sense that. And maybe I'm just very, very fortunate. But we've got, you know, I'm not saying just because they're here, but we've got a great relationship. It's a give and take. It's part of what media and coach, that's what it's been for a long time. I would agree with Pete. Where is the roster limit of players and coaches? Where's the roster limit of the definition of what media is? I don't know what that is.
Right.
And so where do I have to respond? Where don't I have to respond? You know, and how that gray is the issue. I think that we're kind of in two rivers colliding here. You know, it's never been an issue of with our media, again, because of accountability. That's never been the, I could disagree, but you could disagree with me too, and that's okay. And we have the ability as human beings to interact. That's great. That's great for our game. That's great for our players. But the anonymous and then you know, again, it just that's where I struggle the most, because you want to be respectful. You don't want to be disrespectful to that person. They're probably working just as hard, but the accountability aspect, I think, really limits, to me, in my perspective, credibility. It just really does.
That makes a lot of sense. I want to talk about just a few issues, because we have people from different perspectives on these issues. I want to talk about playoffs a little bit, because this is the issue with the BCS folks right now. I think last month they announced they had 50 to 60 different proposals on how to refine the BCS in a playoff system. They've been meeting. Right, exactly.
Sorry.
Well, we'll hear an outline of that later. I think, the last 2 days they've been meeting in Dallas to try to narrow that down to 48 proposals, I think they're down to, or something like that. So there's a lot of ideas out there right now. I know, Fitz, you've usually been a traditionalist. Do you want a playoff? Do you want change?
I think it's all good. but frankly, it needs to be player and student-athlete centered. That's my biggest concern. There's been talk of scholarship reduction. We're already right now in our league, when you go through the conference schedule, then you have to play a conference championship game. Now I might have to play a playoff game to have an opportunity to play in a national championship game with finals. The Big Ten had a great tradition of Thanksgiving break. When the students went home, the student athletes had an opportunity to go home. That's eliminated now. So I'm a football coach. I understand my role, and I would just, and I know that this discussion came up. I'm not speaking out of turn. We met as head coaches as the Big Ten. As long as the student athlete is centered in whatever discussions there are, and what's important for them is in the discussion, then we'll go play wherever we get the opportunity to play. And I think if you were to ask any student athlete, they want to play as many games as they can. But it's a slippery slope. How many games are we going to ask young men to play? It's not. It's a contact sport. If we don't, just in case everybody wants to know. So, if at a certain point, guys get in, and now is the game on the field, because we said we needed a playoff. I mean, we can keep going and bantering it, but is it going to start to diminish? Because I think you said, was it Stu that you said in your story about the third team quarterback stepping up and winning the national championship for us?
That's how I see things going, and 2024. when it's they go through a 16-team playoff, it's going to be Texas beats the equivalent of Butler in the championship game, because after all the injuries and everything, their third string quarterback persevered, something like that.
Well, you guys are watching these discussions professionally. Can you give me your quick take on what you think should happen versus what you think will happen?
I don't think what will happen will be student athlete centric. It's a noble notion, it's an idealistic notion, and no decision that's been made in college football in the last 10 years, when the money has gone from big to ridiculous, has been made, let's do what's best for the student athlete. They've simply opened up the vaults and shoveled money in, and the student athlete has been a second thought. As television networks have come, as TV deals have just gone to literally billion-dollar TV deals. Every major conference has a billion-dollar television deal. And the student-athletes, all they represent when these deals are made are inventory. That's really been the key word in college sports the last 2 years. They need inventory, which is games. Games go on TV. Student-athletes happen to play in the games. And I really feel like the decision-making process has gone from there down, with the student-athlete being a convenient person putting on uniform. It's like the old Seinfeld laundry thing, more people are watching them run around in the laundry, so therefore they're worth more money. And, I think it will end up with a four-team playoff, and you have to love college sports. They call it a plus one because they don't like the word playoff. So literally 8 years ago or whatever, when they came up with this, they didn't want to call it a playoff because they thought it would scare the presidents. So now when you see it, it's still like in normal media, they call it a plus one system, even though it's three more games. And it ends up in, it's the Final Four. It's the Final Four of football. It'll happen in a different parameter. And I do think we will end up with that. Some of the nuances haven't really been drilled down yet, whether it's going to be, neutral sites or traditional bowls or whatever it will be. But I guarantee you, whatever it will be because they can get the most money for it.
What about
I think
you?
There's two guarantees. I think that the four-team playoff is happening. I'm not so sure about the home sites. That sounds like it's going to be pretty contentious. So yeah, I think that'll happen, and then the second thing that'll happen is that nobody will be happy about it. Whatever they come up with, 70% of the fans will immediately complain about. In a lot of the discussions, you'll hear them say, most people are on board with this now, but one of the holdups is concern that as soon as they go to 4, it's going to go to 8 and then to 16. And then, of course, most fans will say, well, big deal. That's what we want. Go ahead, do it. I don't think people understand just how much the sport would change, and whether it's better or worse, I don't know. But if you, I think 4, you're fine. I think 4, every game still matters for the most part. The regular season's still very important. Once you go to an 8 or 16-team playoff, the goal of every team in the country switches from let's try to get to win our conference and get to the best bowl game possible to playoff or bust, just like the NFL. The difference is there's only 32 teams in the NFL, and with a salary cap and with draft and whatnot, most teams go into every season with the realistic hope of making the playoff. In college football, there's going to be those 10, 15 royalty programs, Florida, Texas, Alabama, et cetera, that this will be great for. For everybody else, you know, suddenly what used to be considered a good season, like going 9-3 and going to the Cotton Bowl or the Capital One Bowl, will be cause to fire the coach because he hasn't gone to the playoff in the last 3 years. Those are the long-term consequences of this that I think the average person doesn't necessarily think about because we're just so desperate to have an undisputed national champion.
And Pete, you mentioned money, so I want to bring in some money facts here on college sports. College football and men's basketball generate more than $6 billion in annual revenue. That's more than the NBA. And since the coaches' contracts, so is a hot topic of discussion as well, to remind people, Ohio State just agreed to pay Urban Meyer $24 million over 6 years. So there's some money being thrown around here. But of course, the question is, how much of it should any of it go to the student athlete? NCAA President Mark Emmert recently told the New York Times that if, quote, if we move to a pay-for-play model, if we're to convert our student athletes to employees of the university, that would be the death of college athletics. Do you guys agree? Disagree? What do you think?
It would be the death of college athletics as we know it. It would no longer be amateur sports. It would no longer be that the players are students who are representatives of the university. They would be paid employees. And you know, just like you've covered in the NBA and NFL, there could be lockouts. There could be, you know, all the things that go. Yeah, there could be. I mean, as soon as these players are made to be employees, then the school becomes their employer and has obligations to compensate them fairly, you know, give them benefits, all that stuff. Anyway, we could go on with that forever. The thing that I always, you know, and a lot of people feel this way, I was at the basketball game last night, I saw a lot of number 24 jerseys. We know who that is. It's John Cherna. but John Cherna's not getting a penny of that, you know. I don't think college players should be paid a salary necessarily, but I certainly think, you know, I was at the Michigan-Notre Dame game last year where they did their retro jerseys, and there were Denard Robinson retro jerseys flying off the shelves. Denard Robinson should be entitled to a cut of that. It's like, that's a no-brainer. Now, probably implementing something like that would be more complicated than people think. There would be implications to that, but there's a lawsuit going through the system now, a huge lawsuit, Ed O'Bannon versus the NCAA. I think it's going to be tried next year. It's over that specific issue of whether it's fair that the NCAA keeps the rights to these players' likeness, not even during their career, but even after they graduate. That, to me, is far more pressing and important than, or I think far more deserving opportunity for the students than whether or not they should be paid employees.
This is obviously one of the evergreen, you know, topics. It's been debated for years and years, and I've often grown wary of it only because of the fact that, first of all, 4 years at Northwestern, what does it run you now? About, I don't know, I would just say $240,000.
Scary amount of money.
Something in that neighborhood. So that's like a, you know, if you're the backup Will linebacker, like that's, you know, it's a pretty good run for 18 to 22, you know, to make. So that's my one take on it. And, you know, you talk about Denard Robinson and obviously, you know, people like John Cherna, people like that are valuable to university. But, you know, what about the guys in the Sun Belt where the football program, you know, at Middle Tennessee State is losing $20 million a year and they're trying to keep their head above water? Do we have to pay them too? I just think if all of a sudden we go there, it, you know, like Sue said, it's complicated. Like there's no silver bullet we'll pay everyone this or that. And right. Then do you pay your five-star recruits but you don't pay your holder? You know, do you not pay your field hockey players? Do you only pay your basketball players? It opens up a Pandora's box, and I think the simple answer is this. If you want to get paid and you're good enough to get paid, go to Canada. You can go at age 18, go play in the CFL. 12 men, 2 guys in motion. And if you're a good basketball player and you feel like you don't want to be subjected to the NCAA system and have them take advantage of you,
You can go to Belgium. You can go to New Zealand. You can go to the D League, Reno. They love you in Tulsa. You know, go have fun. You know, that's always a bit. It's very cut and dried for me in this issue. You know what you're signing up for. There's very, very little interest in the high administrative level, and very little interest in the coaching level, and very little interest in the presidential level of ever opening this can of worms. So certainly at the Final Four, when you see that UCLA or whoever is bringing all this money to the school, you know, you can bring it up. I remember, who's the good receiver at Ohio State, who's on the Colts now, who's a smart guy?
Anthony Gonzalez.
So at the BCS title game 1 year, he kind of came out and said, we're the most abused group of people ever. Well, what about in the state of Ohio, where Ohio University is losing money hand over fist, and there's four other Division I schools that are doing, like, you know, and if you don't like it, go to Canada.
Well, Pat, you're in an interesting position on this, because on the one hand, you've got all of these complicating factors in the program.
Right.
But these are real kids to you. These are kids, they're like your kids in some way. And
absolutely.
You see the ones who have real need and when they do struggle and where the university can or can't step in. Right. Where do you stand on this issue?
Well, I obviously, as a coach, you'd love to be able to provide whatever you need, whatever your student athletes need to be able to be happy, to be successful. And if helping them financially will alleviate some of the stresses of their life, meaning hardship back home and things of that nature, to help them have whatever we would categorize as a normal experience from a standpoint of their peers on campus, then I think there's not a coach or an administrator or a president that would not feel that way. It gets really complicated. And how do you implement, you know, and is it just for the revenue sports compared to the non-revenue sports? Now let's talk about gender equality. You know, I mean, there's so many issues that arise into it. And, you know, we were talking upstairs, you know, I have a like every team in intercollegiate athletics, there's a handful of your student athletes that have a higher need than the $2,000 that were talked about before. And so does the $2,000 really alleviate those issues? And then I have a big group of student athletes that I'm not sure where that $2,000 is gonna go to, because they don't need that $2,000. You know, so should we say, hey man, I don't need it. Hey, why don't you take mine, Pete? I got my two. Why don't you, here, I don't need it. I know you do. Here's my, so now do we go, I mean, where are we gonna go with this? Where's the checks and balances? And so I think it's very, very complicated. But I don't believe there's a coach in the country that wouldn't say, if our players need it, let's help them. But I'd also say there wouldn't be a professor on this campus that wouldn't say, if we have a student in need, let's help them too. You know, and so, I mean, it's really, really complicated.
I give Fitz credit, because when this issue came up in the spring, all these coaches were tripping over themselves to say they were in favor of paying everyone just because it would help them in the recruiting trail.
Sure.
Like Steve Spurrier came out and was like, pay them all. You know,
it's so.
So when he goes to.
Steve Spurrier could pay them.
And it was so
and
like.
Redskins money.
Yeah. It was so self-serving. It was like they had to go to the chiropractor. They were like patting themselves on the back. Oh, we need to pay you.
Right.
Well, I do want to ask you about recruiting a little bit, and to give, I think the media sometimes gets a skewed view of recruiting, and of course the blogs blow up recruiting.
Sure.
So first, I want to know your best line here. This is kind of like picking up a girl in the bar, right? When you're in the recruit's house and things, you know, it's between you and another school, maybe the big state school, big football program.
Sure. Well,
what's your best line of reasoning here to convince someone
well,
to go to Northwestern?
Well, I'm a high school sweetheart, so I wasn't very good in the bar, but... You know, honestly, I think you take it right back to that young person. And they're going to hear a lot of rumor and innuendo and smoke and mirrors in this process. It's what do you want out of your experience in college? And you have put yourself in a great opportunity to have the privilege to play college football. What do you want to use that vehicle? And what is the destination? Where do you want to go? And ask a kid at times to say, okay, I know you haven't thought about what you're doing on Saturday and it's Wednesday. But if you could close your eyes and dream, what do you want to be doing at 30? And hopefully you hear from a young person, I want to play in the NFL with a degree. Okay, great. All right, now close it again. Now fast forward 10 more years. What do you want to be doing at 40? You're not playing in the NFL anymore. What do you want to do when you're 50? Keep dreaming. This is not the end here of your development. This is just the beginning. And so use this vehicle called football to take you wherever it is that your dreams are. And a lot of kids haven't thought about it that way. And now In comes the fanfare of recruiting and the glorification of those players. And they get put up on a pedestal, and each game's a little different. I know you're in basketball. I'm glad I'm a football coach. But in football, at a certain point, a certain kid gets put a star on them, and it's almost like a rating of beef. And gosh, if I go to a restaurant and it doesn't have five-star beef, I'm not eating there. and the restaurant dies, right? And that's now we're having people that have no idea who these kids are putting a rating on a young person that's defining their worth or what they're worth. And to me, again, I'm not trying to be overly negative today, but it's just really tough. I remember what it was like to be 15 years old and dream of playing Big Ten football, and I couldn't wait to have that happen for me. And you know what? If I opened up the Daily Southtown or the Star and the local guy knew who I was, it was really cool. If I got in the Tribune, it was like, wow. If I got into some time, it was like, wow, I just got an article written. Your mom cut it out, you know, it went in a little thing, and here we go. You know, now it's like, I'm a 3-star guy. I'm not very good. You know, and I'm not getting very heavily recruited. And I get the opportunity to see it from the kids' perspective. I'm not that far removed. And so what I think has happened is recruiting has now become the second season for fans. That's what's happened. And whoever can give fan that information has grabbed the vacuum, and here we are. And so the fans get excited about it. And because fans get excited about it, we get clicks on our website. And every click I get, and if I got more fans clicking on that website, if I rate that kid a 4-star, I bet you I get more clicks. Oh, up he goes. He's a 5-star kid. Game hasn't changed. Hasn't changed his game. So I'm not buying it. I don't believe in it. I think it's just, again, I'll go back to the players. I think it's setting the player up for failure. I just really do. And you know what? If they just have fun, enjoy playing football, they're going to go. So what's my story? Use football to take you where you want to go to achieve your dreams. So that's it. It's that simple.
It's a good line. You could have used that too. I'm glad that your wife though got in early, so it's okay.
She was an early commit.
Let me put it this way.
Right, she was an early commit.
I was an early commit.
Right.
I'll just put it to you that way.
I mean, I would imagine, because I cover a lot more pro sports, and this is an area that I'm thankfully don't have to deal with, because I would imagine from a media perspective, it's gotta be one of the hardest things you guys cover. Is that right?
Yeah, you know, I'm by no means a recruiting junkie. You know, we kind of let the rivals.com and scouts, they've kind of cornered that market, and we kind of come in toward the end of the cycle. But what Fitz is describing, I think, is unavoidable. This is the college football in particular, second most popular sport in America. And I think what happened was recruiting was completely undercovered for most of history until really the internet sites came along. When you think about it, and you think about the intense fan interest in these teams, and I don't know, what percent of your year do you spend devoted onto recruiting?
365 days.
Yeah, so why wouldn't the fans be obsessed with it 365 days a year? This is this is the NFL draft, only it's more important because there's no other way to pick up the players, you know? So it stands to reason the fans would want that information and want it year round. And so is there a way to get fans that information without, you know, kind of elevating these kids' status or degrading their status? I don't know. It's not going to go away. I mean, signing day is going to get bigger every year. Recruiting coverage is going to get wider every year because the interest in this sport is going up, and as an extension, the interest in recruiting is going up.
Recruiting is very simple. It's reality television for sports, right? You have a kid, and then you have 5 suitors, you know, Michigan, Northwestern, Ohio State, whoever, and you get to watch, what is it, they pick the rose or something from The Bachelor? I mean, it's all that. In the high-profile recruitments, you know about the kid's girlfriend. You know about where his brother goes to school. You know if his dad has a job. You know everything about them, and then you follow it along. Like, oh, he crossed Duke off his list. Oh, he crossed this person off his list. And Fitz hit the nail on the head earlier. It's competition. So Ohio State plays Michigan once a year. On the recruiting trail, they go up against each other 30 or 40 times. So if you love Ohio State or you love Michigan, it's just like another game, and it's where you channel your energy in those 8 months a year where you don't have games to follow. And if you're obsessive, and America is obsessed with finding the next thing before anyone else knows about it. You know, they want to see LeBron James when he's, you know, in eighth grade. People are fascinated by, like, the next whatever, and that's what recruiting is. It's sifting through everything. The problem is, because of the system and because of the media coverage and everything, a lot of kids start to believe they're great when they're at a certain point, and then people tell them they don't have to work hard, they move around, and they become too big and often end up failing. This is one of my favorite recruiting things. I learned this last summer that ties us back to Twitter a little bit. Now, Rivals and Scout were both sold for, I think, over $90 million 4 or 5 years ago. So you want to talk about big business. You're talking about hundreds of millions of dollars in calling, you know, Johnny 5-star in Evanston and saying, what are your 5 schools? How did you like your visit to, you know, Michigan State? Whatever it is. The recruiting guys have a problem now, though, because their goal was to beat their rival into finding out where Johnny's going to go. Well, Johnny's become the journalist.
He breaks the story on Twitter all the time. Right. So the Rivals and Scout guys, their use for these $100 million businesses has become less because the kids disseminate the information themselves. So I think it's sort of like a beautiful full circle in the recruiting game.
All four of us went to what we like to consider academically oriented schools. I mean, even though Pete went to Syracuse, so we'll love that. What is the challenge for schools that do have strong academic standards for recruiting and sort of how you cross that line between getting the best kids but still maintaining those standards? And that's sort of the age-old problem for schools like Northwestern, but has that blurred a little bit in some ways? And Notre Dame, I mean, you know, some of the big, you know, Stanford obviously is able to field a great program and have high standards. Where does all that stand with schools like Northwestern, Stanford, maybe Syracuse, you know, whatever?
No, not even close. I'm being dead serious. There's five schools probably in the BCS that have high academic standards. Now, they're not, you know, of your typical Medill student or whatever, but I would think it's Northwestern, it's Vanderbilt, it's Notre Dame, it's Stanford, and then you could maybe Duke, you could maybe, there's about 5 out of 60 which have that legitimately. Others will say they do in posture, and there might be like a, you know, non-BCS basketball, but literally that's it. You know, like, I will not pretend Syracuse, you know, has any kind of, you know, look, they run great programs and do great jobs, and, you know, in football they graduate their kids. But for the most part, it's been great, honestly, to see the last 4 or 5 years, to see Vanderbilt really succeed, especially in basketball, see Notre Dame succeed in basketball. You see what Harvard's doing in competing in basketball on a high end now. I mean, because it's hard to do that. It's really hard to win at these schools when you're recruiting from a much smaller pool.
So are you guys getting better at it as coaches, or are the standards getting lower?
I think players at the high school level are valuing their education. I mean, they want a great education. They want to go to a great school. They understand, and there's more information out there about the realities of the National Football League than maybe there were when I was coming out of high school. I mean, so, you know, what we see is that there's more information out there, which is positive. I mean, when I went through the recruiting process, this is one of the positive aspects of the internet. There's an opportunity for you to receive more information. I had no idea how to get recruited, I had two sisters. Nobody else went to, you know, I had no idea what to do. So there's a lot of information out there, which is positive. Mm-hmm. But, you know, the how you do it, I think it more has to do with what your fit is for your program. And I think that starts at the leadership of the university. It goes through the administration, the athletic department, and the head coach, and what the expectations are. And I think that the balance then is with, again, your fans. You know, if you have, you know, a certain set of standards academically, it doesn't mean you're not going to have a great football team. Whoever said that? Why is it because you have great students that you can have a great football team? I've never bought into that notion. But a lot of people don't have great academics and they don't have a great team, so they got to say, well, you can never win there. It's too hard, you know, and all that stuff. So it's the balance of society again. So I think it goes back to, that's just an excuse. I think it's a crutch to say that, you know, we can't win because we have high academic standards. I don't believe in that. I don't buy into it. I think it's the other way around. We've got smart kids, and that's why we win. We've got guys that have done the right things, not some of the time, but all the time. That's why we win. You know, it makes my job a lot easier. I'm not a babysitter holding kids' hands to go to class. Make sure not only they're in their class when they walk in, but then I'm sitting here waiting, hiding behind the tree to make sure when they walk out that I'm right there like, ah, I gotcha. You know, like I've had to. They're motivated. That's why they're here. The admission standards alleviated that. And I'm not saying the young people that aren't here aren't great. I'm not saying that at all. I'm just saying that's who we are. And I think the sooner that you're in my role, you realize who you are and what you stand for and what you value, the easier it is for you as a coach to have a roadmap to find success. It's never going to be easy, and it doesn't make it any easier at schools that don't have high academic standards or lower academic. I think it more has to do with you recruiting to your right fit. And when you do that, you've got a chance to have a culture of success.
I want to talk to you guys, too. We're going to take some questions pretty soon. But one of the other topics I wanted to hit quick before we do is this idea of the media relationship to coaches, icon, and sort of fans as well. We certainly saw the Penn State situation in this past year kind of change everything on that front. And sort of, do you think that because of how things unfolded at Penn State, I know, Pat, you went and visited there after Coach Paterno died. And do you think that idea of that lionized coaches icon has sort of gone away now that we've sort of been through this experience? Or do you think in this era of, I just mentioned Urban Meyer's salary, I mean, do you think that this rock star recruiting and things that we're still having that? Well, and how does the media play into that?
I wrote that very column the week after he got fired. I mean, you know, there's no way we could possibly talk up here about all the things that may have contributed to what happened at Penn State, but I certainly think the culture that was there for 45 years, where this one man was lionized and everybody kind of answered to him, probably contributed to it. And so I said, you know, it would be a good lesson from this that we in the media, because we're as guilty of it as anybody, fans, everybody, take a step back and say, look, it's perfectly great to compliment a coach for winning games and whatever he's done well, you know, he's very good at his job. But the way we deify some of these coaches, it's unbelievable. But is that going to change? Are people going to actually learn that lesson? I don't know. I mean, Alabama just built a statue of Nick Saban outside their stadium. The guy is still coaching there. I mean,
You're shaking your head.
I don't want to. I am for no, it's not going to change. It doesn't change with the players. You know, and it goes back to passion. I mean, fans are passionate about their schools. If I went to the school and I graduated from the school, it's my school. It's my school, and it's my coach, and it's my team. And there's nothing, that's great. But again, here we go. There's two edges of the sword. You know, Coach Paterno told us a great story, and I'll be a little general, but he talked about when he first got into the profession that the beat reporters would go over to his house for drinks after games on Saturdays. They'd come over on Fridays before the games. There's that much trust between Coach Paterno and his beat reporters. And of kind of getting into that circle of, not to quote a movie, but the circle of trust, you know, was special. And there was, and then all of a sudden, somebody wrote something that had inside information, and the doors were closed. And nobody was ever let back in. And it again goes back to trust. And it can be built up over time, or it can erode over time. And it just seems like right now, it's all about the next, what's the next hot story? And then it just seems like the cycle stops. What's next? Stops. You know? And it just, what's up today? And that's what, as the media is kind of flattened out, as you guys alluded to earlier, it just seems that that's where we're at today. And you know, again, we're talking about people here, that are, you know, human beings, and it's really, really tough. And, you know, that's a great example of I would call it a tsunami. That was a media tsunami. Everything that had anything to do with there was just wiped out. Whether or not it was good or bad, it didn't matter. It was just wiped out. And there was positive reporting and negative reporting. There was great stories, bad stories. There's sunshine now put on kids that were being, you know, there's so many different ways you can go with it. But that the tsunami is now gone, and in the wake of is what's remaining. And we'll see how that rebuilds. And I no disrespect to anyone who's been impacted by a tsunami, but that's what it looks like to me from an outsider, from a standpoint of that's what it looked like. I mean, that's
Pete, do you think Pat's going to get a statue of him outside of?
No. I'll answer that for you.
I think it'll be interesting as we go forward, Rachel, with lessons learned. When now you look at the so-called iconic coaches who are in college basketball, who are looking at the sunset, Mike Krzyzewski, Jim Boeheim, guys like that. Who,
sure,
you know,
thrilled to hear you say that, by the way.
Yeah, well, I mean, I'll be curious. Do you think Jim Calhoun wishes he didn't retire 6 months ago? He's out with a back injury. His program suspended from the NCAA tournament last year. His team is by far and away the most disappointing and underachieving in all of college basketball. And it's just like, you know, all of a sudden he could have walked out into the sunset, and you know, what more did he have to accomplish at age 70, I think, you know, having won another national title. Now instead, he's not only probably gonna have to leave his administrators in a tough decision. Do you keep him on for another year to play through a season with no NCAA tournament, where recruiting is gonna be difficult, and then bring him back at 72 to try it again? And all of a sudden, you know, one of the problems with the Paterno thing, I've wrote so many stories about when is Joe going to retire and who has the power and everything like that. You know, maybe a hope out of this generally is that the coach doesn't have say. And just, you know, if you're a president and you saw what happened at Penn State, I mean, they tried to run Joe 5-6 years before, at least to get him to say, okay, let's set up a plan and let's set up an exit and different things like that. And he rebuffed that. I think any president who saw that unfold, just generally from how Joe just sort of clung to his job with white knuckles, they have to say, look, you know, who's in charge here?
All right, well, I want to open this up to questions. Got to wait for the mic to come to you. A lot of different topics, obviously, we've already broken into, so feel free to introduce anything you want. And well, Mark over there has the mic. He'll be the chooser. He's the decider, is that right? That's the...
So, what do you guys think about the news glorification of Jeremy Lin?
Ask her. I think we should ask Rachel.
I'm just the moderator. I don't have any opinions. Go ahead, guys.
I think it's kind of what Pat just said. You know, we're always the media cycle now is what's the next big story. They're always looking for it, and he is obviously the big story right now. But unlike, there were all these comparisons to Tim Tebow's story, and I just never understood that. I mean, Tim Tebow was a Heisman Trophy winner and a first-round draft pick, and everybody knew his name, and this was not some sort of, like, underdog story, you know? This Jeremy Lin is kind of the ultimate underdog story. It makes sense that people would rally around that, and that it would become this huge story. Now, you use the word glorification. That's kind of how sports has always been. I mean, we glorify athletes, we glorify coaches, like we talked about. The consequence of that, I think, today is that they fall harder. You know, we build them up, and then as soon as somebody stumbles, and I'm sure everybody's waiting for Jeremy Lin to go through a cold shooting slump, so they can say, "See, we told you. He didn't live up to the hype." That drives me crazy about it.
But all right, are you waiting for that?
No.
Are you?
I'm not personally.
Are you?
But there's the Twitter universe probably is.
So I mean, that's the thing is that I do hear that all the time, and I'm always interested in that because I think the general public. I mean, you do ask about the media interest in Jeremy Lin. Most of the media is interested in selling papers or selling advertising on TV. Trust me, if the ratings weren't there, these news organizations wouldn't be putting that information out there. They are very sensitive to what the public wants and what the public is watching, more so in some ways than ever before. If there's such passion and interest and like of Jeremy Lin at the moment, do you think there's a bunch of people waiting to tear him down? And is that a small minority? And does the public just go to sort of the media and Twitter world and everyone just go along with that? Or do you think that's almost false at this point? What do you think?
I think there's a certain four-letter sports network that has a lot of afternoon programming where certain people on those programs really like to take hyperbolic positions on certain people like Tim Tebow, like Jeremy Lin and such, and they've made reputations and careers on filling time on that certain four-letter network by screaming their opinions as loud as possible. Yeah. and I do think there is that culture where, like, you know, screaming has become news, and I do think that's a bad trend generally for journalism, where you have a take, and then you have to support that take, and then your take becomes part of your brand, and you know it's not a trend I've enjoyed, but you know, Jeremy Lin will have three bad games, then Nichols will hit a tailspin, and maybe you'll be close to missing the playoffs, and I told you he wasn't that good, and then you know it's that sort of culture that gets fed into, and you know, those are the people who are waiting for him to slip up so they can jump on him. I think it's a great story because I watched him as a sophomore. I live in Boston. I watched him as a sophomore at Harvard, and he shot 62% from the free throw line and 28% from three. And I think the best part of the Jeremy Lin story is that he made it himself. You know, it was very simple. He got, you know, an opportunity at one of the, quite frankly, when he got there, one of the worst college basketball programs in the country, and he simply made himself into a great player.
This is for Stewart and Pete. You were talking about the Penn State scandal and using it as kind of an example. What are the challenges of covering a story that, you know, stops being sports after a while, and you have CNN and you have, you know, Brian Williams coming in and starting to cover a story, and where, as sports writers, how do you deal with that?
You were there.
I was there for 3 weeks. It was interesting. I think one of the best lessons that I learned early on, luckily covering Syracuse, some of their players got arrested when I was the beat writer when I got out of school. You learned, and I'm half joking, but I'm really not. You learn how to, you know, deal with lawyers. You learn how to deal with court records. You learn how to deal with police records. You learn how to, you know, deal with district attorneys and different things like that. And it was a very accidental way to an important lesson where if you're going to be a sports writer, you should spend one summer of your life covering cops and courts and different things like that. Because I spent, especially in the last 6 months of my life, I've spent more time, and even with the Cam Newton thing like last year, spent more time doing outside of sports reporting. Like, I would say in the last 6 months, between realignment and between the Penn State and Syracuse scandals, I spent 80% of my time not writing about sports. I've gone to very few games even. I remember I got to the national title game, it felt like a vacation, because I was like, oh, I'm writing about a football player today. And I think if anyone in here wants to be in the sports media, be it in the broadcast side or be it in the print side, you have to know that other stuff, because just covering sports now, it's, you know, you have to be able to do a little bit of everything.
As a columnist, that the whole Penn State story was the biggest challenge of my career, because I'm, as a person who, like you said, needs to have a take, when that grand jury report came out and I read it, I was like, my gosh, I am not remotely qualified to talk about this. I'm not an expert on child molestation, and I don't know that any, you know, many sports writers are. And so, you know, I was going to take my time on it. And of course, in the today's news cycle, you can't. I mean, it didn't take more than 24 hours for very respected sports columnists to come out and say, they did this wrong, you did this wrong, you did this wrong, this person needs to be fired. And it was really tough, because that's just not my nature. I kind of want to look at it from a more nuanced angle. And so when I finally did write something that was a little bit down the middle, I mean, it was just such an emotional and visceral issue for people that I immediately got, you're pro-child molestation. How can you write that? How can you? I'm never going to read you again. You supported a rapist. Just by daring to suggest anything short of, you know, the extreme. So I think I eventually got my bearings. But like Pete said, there's, whether it's conference realignment or some of the scandals that have gone on, Cam Newton, Miami, Ohio State, we've spent a lot of time, I'd say, in the last 18 months writing about stuff off the field.
You can tell this is mostly journalism students, because the coach of Northwestern football is sitting up here, and all the questions are for these two.
This is awesome.
Keep going.
Pat, what's your quarterback situation?
It's not spring ball yet. No comment.
Okay. Mark, who's your next victim? Yep.
This is for all four of you. I've been watching a lot of college football, and my question is, can you please explain to me why, with the likes of Missouri, Arkansas, and all that, why college realignment has become such a big issue and why teams are on the move a lot? Can you please explain to me that, please?
Do we have another hour?
I know. Well, Pat, your conference just got bumped up to, well, not just, but it's been bumped up to 12 teams. Now, is this good? Is this bad? Do you think, I mean, you've got teams in the SEC now who play each other every 4 or 5 years. Right. I mean, why even be in a conference together?
You know, you two gentlemen could speak for a lot more what's going on nationally. You know, I know what's been portrayed to us from the leadership of our conference, and I also know where now, as we've gone down 1 year, you know, I think we've positioned ourselves in a place where we kind of have our Midwest footprint. Now we've defined the Midwest from Nebraska to Pennsylvania. Well, it's changed, but that we kind of have our Midwest footprint, that's who we are, that's our identity, and where we go from here, I have no idea, but I think we have our identity. And where I look at some other conferences, and as I am a traditionalist, I just kind of struggle with the team in the left coast playing a team in the right coast for the championship of the conference. But that's the way it was when I grew up. I don't know if that's the way it's going to be when I'm a grandfather. I doubt it, but I'll be brutal. It's all about money, right?
It is.
It's all about money, and there's a lot of money out there, and I just coached the team. So they tell you who you're going to play. I mean, I don't think a coach got a vote. Do you want to go to the SEC? Yes. Great, we're going. You know? No, we don't. No, we're not going. It's not the way it goes.
I don't think any of us foresaw how quickly and dramatically the TV dollars would rise. I mean, the Pac-12, when they renegotiated their deal after they got Colorado and Utah, went from, I don't know the exact number, I want to say like $825 million a year to $3 billion a year. I mean, the numbers just shot up so quickly, starting with the Big Ten and the Big Ten Network and then the SEC and so forth. And so it's just this great money grab going on. Which conference do I go in so that'll have the best deal, that'll have the most stability, and kind of the traditional reasons for conference alignment, geography, relationships, you know, things you have in common, are just taking a back seat to who's got the best TV deal, who's got the, you know, who's going to get my brand in the most households. You know, I think that's the single driving factor behind realignment.
A great phrase I learned in the last 2 years was that college football, which I'm sure is why you got into it, is DVR-proof programming. All right? So it's hard to advertise on television now because nobody watches TV. They just DVR it and fast forward through the commercials. Well, college football is a compelling live event, and there's a lot of it, and most people watch it live, so they watch the commercials. And so college football has got more popular. The demand to advertise on live sports has become more popular. Now I think there's like 17 ESPNs now, something like that. You know, so yeah, you got to fill the Ocho with something. So you put Arkansas State on the Ocho. NBC has NBC Sportsnet now. CBS has CBS College Sports now. And at the end of the day, it goes back to follow the money in inventory. And that's why. And rivalries are burned. Longtime relationships are burned. The student athletes are certainly inconvenienced, you know, greatly, as are coaches, you know, just with travel schedules and such. But
there's more inventory, so we get to see that classic Missouri-Georgia game.
Everyone's been waiting for.
Yeah.
Yeah?
Going along on that same topic, and with the expansion of the conferences and different conferences trying to jump on, piggyback on the success of networks like the Big Ten Network, and a conference network that just covers those specific schools, having been in and around the Big Ten Network when the Penn State story broke, they had a really difficult time figuring out how do we cover this because the schools pay for us to be running. So in terms of media organizations, what, and you two work for media organizations that, you know, are supposed to be right down the line, you have columns and things like that, but you know, you print the news that's, it shows both sides. With a conference network, you don't necessarily, it might be a little bit more difficult. So moving forward, and if more conferences were to, you know, kind of tap into that, what difficulties do you see in the future covering college sports?
More access issues like we talked about earlier. You know, Texas started the Longhorn Network this year, and even though nobody can see it, they did actually go through a year with it. And oh, I'm sorry, that's another four letter. My bad. I have nothing to do with the swimsuit issue. You have nothing to do with the Longhorn Network.
So. Probably good on both accounts.
That's what you tell your wife, anyway.
It was extremely frustrating for the beat writers there because the Longhorn Network they got whatever they wanted. They had cameras in practice, you know, the media wasn't allowed to talk to the quarterbacks, but the Longhorn Network was. And I can't necessarily argue with that. They're paying huge amounts of money for that access. So, I think the idea of these networks is great for fans. I do. I'm looking forward to the start of the Pac-12 Network being in the Bay Area. But it is going to, you can tell if you feel the same way. I think that the model toward conferences and teams controlling the narrative a little bit more, controlling the wanting to tell their story, which they should be doing. I mean, all the pro leagues do it, means that they're going to get certain access and certain privileges that the, as you call it, kind of down the line, down the middle outlets won't.
Do you find yourself doing that, Pat? Are you either asked to by your sports information people or just by your own wanting to, giving different, better access to the Big Ten Network because you're sort of trying to help our boys, our guys?
You know, I'm not at this point. I would think that maybe my model is a little different maybe than our peers, and I would ask the people from the network, but we have access for our daily Northwestern beat reporters like we do for the Big Ten Network, and they're able to come to practice, and this is the rules of the road, and just don't hurt the student athletes and don't hurt the program. And we'll move forward from there. And if you ask me a question that I'm going to decide not to answer, I hope you respect I'm doing that to protect the student athlete or to protect the program. Again, we have human interaction, so it ends up working out well. And I think through that access, we've been able to build a relationship. But yeah, I think schools have allowed now networks to buy access, and you get it. You paid more. You don't. You're a student. I mean, it probably can go all the way down to that extreme. But for our sake here now, we've I think got a pretty solid relationship built up no matter who you are.
And you're right, it does happen in the pros. And one of the things that happened with the NFL Network recently is that you had a report come out recently with the whole Peyton Manning Colts situation and came out on the NFL Network. And then you had Jim Irsay, the owner, on Twitter disputing the NFL Network. And it was sort of, but you own the NFL Network. So you get into that too on the other side where then there's counter and you have real good reporters working for those networks doing their jobs journalistically, and then there's issues there as well. So it is a complicated crossing of the lines, I think.
Hi. So we've obviously touched a lot on the problems that have come out in the NCAA recently. Pete said that maybe 5 out of the 60 BCS conference programs can recruit with like academic standards. It's obviously something that not a lot of schools find sustainable or something that they want to do. And Pete also said that if kids don't want to sign up for this system, that they can go to a different country and play. And I think that brings up an interesting dilemma because it looks like we're the only country really that does amateur athletics like this. It just looks like it looks like there's a conflict of interest between high-level academics and revenue-generating athletics. And I was just wondering what you guys think about the issue, if you think big change is coming. I know that kind of hurts a lot of your jobs up there, but what you guys think about that.
I'd just go cover cops, so I'd be fine.
You know, it is a conflict of interest inherently at, I'd say, more than 90% of the colleges that play in Division I sports. You're absolutely right. It is a conflict of interest. But it's a very popular conflict of interest. You know, homecoming's based around it. TV networks are based around it. And it's also a very profitable conflict of interest for a good chunk of the schools that participate. There is talk, and it's probably closer than maybe we think it is, of maybe the BCS schools break away from the NCAA, or we go to four 16-team conferences. Is that the right math? And then those schools, you know, encompass the NCAA tournament. You hear whispers of that, you know, when you come up to these TV negotiations and they're throwing things around. They're basically, the whole thing with college sports, the people that run it, which is really BCS, is everyone's sitting around the table, and there's really six players, probably five and a half now, if you're honest, and they all have a certain chunk of the cookie. And everyone clings to their chunk of the cookie with just white-knuckle fervor. And they don't want wholesale change because they like the racket they have now, quite frankly. Okay, so our labor's free, we make a ton of money, you know, we're where we are, why would they possibly change? So at the end of the day, the people who are benefiting so much from the conflict of interest that I don't see any type of wholesale crazy change.
You've also got generations and generations of loyalty, you know, people, you know, Alabama fans who, you know, generation after generation have grown up rooting for the University of Alabama. The idea that you could, you know, turn the Alabama football team into some sort of professional organization separate from the university. I mean, you could take the exact same players and put them in just in, you know, give them a different name, the Alabama something or others. That's not what the fans, that's not what their interest is. They're not rooting. They're rooting for the University of Alabama. They may not have gone there. They may have no interest in the academic side of it, but that's the school that they've grown up rooting for, and they're always going to root for it. And so it's kind of like the train left the station a long time ago. I think there will be changes. I mean, I think you'll see some pretty significant NCAA changes in the next year or so, but nothing, you know, that changes the entire model of how they do this thing.
This question is for Coach Fitz mainly. You hear a lot about recruits who might watch a Boise State game on TV or watch an Oregon game, and they see the blue field or the wacky uniforms, and that's sort of what puts the program on the map for them. So now with Northwestern has this new uniform deal with Under Armour, I was just wondering if you think that, you know, if Northwestern was to play on like a purple field or have wild uniforms, if you think that would help you in your recruiting process, or if you think that would be a distraction for you.
Yeah, you know, I became a big Harry Potter fan, so I was going to try to make an invisible jersey, see if that would fly. You know, trying to win a national championship, so let's rock and roll. But the Under Armour folks said they're a little bit behind right now, they're not going to be able to get that done. It's all brand recognition. That's what it is. And so when you look at Alabama, or maybe you look at Penn State, what do you think of plain? The numbers on the helmet? Nothing on the helmet. It goes from that simple side to the Smurf turf, right? I worked at the University of Idaho. That's what we call it, the Smurf turf. You know, so, but Boise takes great pride in that. And that's again, plays into your brand and who you are. And, you know, when we played Auburn, it was everything ended in War Eagle. And if I was smart enough, I would have trademarked what the first time I said go Cats 7 years ago. I could have retired already and been playing golf with Michael Jordan. Now everybody says go Cats. So that's just the way it goes. I mean, it was unbelievable. Everybody, it was like, and you saw the commercials on your network, you know, Roll Tide. You know, just that's what you identify with your brand. So do I think we'll play on purple turf? No, I hope not. I really don't. I really, really don't. you know, I think that's all kind of part of the fabric and the story of college football.
And teams are getting recognition for this. Yes, you have these super traditional programs, Notre Dame, Penn State, that are recognized for the uniforms, but you have a whole group of teams in between that by having these crazy uniforms, look at what happened with Maryland this season.
Yeah, they went 2-10.
People, well.
but yeah, it's funny, but people don't talk about that.
You talk about the helmet,
you talk about the uniform, and that's the brand.
Before you said that and said, what do you remember about Maryland football this year? I bet that more people in this room would talk about, oh, those uniforms with the things on that. What is that, jousting? I mean, you know, and they would not know that they went 2-10. And so if you're a coach recruiting for that program and trying to hide a 2-10 record, that's an advantage for you. I mean, do you think about, I mean, you look at what's happened at Oregon, and do you think about, hey, we have this new deal, let's do something a little crazy.
Yeah, I actually have the pictures here. Nah, I'm not going to show you. Yeah, I mean, there's a huge recruiting component to everything you do. everything goes back to recruiting. So there's no question that that plays into it. But also, you know, here at Northwestern, we have a set of values that we want to believe in. So when you talk about that, I mean, from the way we want to look. And I got a little exotic at the Penn State game last year, and oh, my gosh, the amount of emails I got. I couldn't see the numbers. The players loved it. What about them? They love the uniforms, but I got more emails. I couldn't see the numbers. Well, I put them on the helmet, too. You know, and we did some different things. It was cool. And more recruits saw that jersey and thought that was the coolest thing ever. I thought we looked like Barney, you know. I thought we looked like Barney with a silver helmet. You know, that was the way, but the guys loved it. And the guys designed it. And it was our, you know, our leadership council that designed the uniform. So, you know, I think it all goes back to recruiting and having fun with the guys. But again, everybody's got a little stake in it.
24 Maryland players have left in the last year, transferred from the program. So you still need a good coach, which is nice to, I am cranky. I've refused to tweet, acknowledge, or write about uniforms or anything like that, partially because so many people care about it, and it just sort of, I don't know, I'm a cranky old man about it. I just don't like it. I just don't like that it, because it's like you're not generating publicity for having good student athletes or winning games even. It's just like, I don't know.
This is what we've learned about Pete in this panel. If you wear too much color on your jersey, get out. And if you don't like the rules, go to Canada. Anyone else?
You can wear anything you want in Canada.
Yeah, piggybacking on that one.
Oh, I'm sorry.
On that one issue you just referred to about going to Canada, Stewart is all for giving Denard Robinson money to, you know, because he's the one
that is generating the money for the University of Michigan. Well, and then, what is it? Pete says, wait a minute, Denard, if you wanna get paid, go to Canada or go someplace else and play. And then Coach says, and this is a hotly contested issue, Coach says, we have student athletes in our program that have need.
So it's almost as if it's complicated.
I don't think so. I mean, it's giving money to the student. And this is a hotly contested issue right now. Can you piggyback on that a little bit?
Well, to be clear, I was talking about a very specific part of compensation. You know, just think that if you're using a player's likeness to sell jerseys, you know, memorabilia, NCAA video games, he should be entitled to a percentage of that. That's, I think, separate from should they have the value of their scholarship increased or the, you know, more extreme viewpoint of should they be paid employees.
It is complicated. I mean, that's the thing that's so hard, and we talked about this before this panel, was that pay for play might be one of the most discussed issues because there's a lot of people who can start with the first part of the sentence of either I do or I don't think that college athletes should be paid. And then it's very hard to know where to go from there because it's so complicated. So it's a very multi-tiered, multifaceted issue. I think someone in the back had the microphone.
Yeah, just going back to the idea of amateur leagues in other countries, and you said going to Canada or going to Europe playing basketball. I think that that's something that's very prominent in this country is college football and college basketball. It's certainly not something that the NHL uses. You know, most players are not going through the college ranks to get to the NHL.
They're from Canada.
Right, and that's true. And the same thing for Major League Baseball is you're seeing less of that kind of focus. And in the media in general, you're seeing more of a focus on college football and college basketball, which is not necessarily true in the professional ranks where Major League Baseball is just as big, if not a bigger player. So just why do any of you kind of see that?
Why is baseball not more popular than hockey?
Why is that lacking?
Because you can bet on it. Yeah. That's really what a lot of it comes down to. Like, we think March Madness is as much about gambling and filling out your tournament pool as it is about loving Butler or VCU or whoever. And I think
some people love Butler.
Yeah, I like Butler, but I really think that, you know, college baseball for some reason has just never caught on. I can't really tell you why. But it doesn't really rate. It doesn't, you know, in certain niches in South
really
Carolina,
big in certain
LSU,
parts of the country, yeah.
It, you know, maybe like USC where you have a lot of talent. But I think the general erosion from baseball, from the American consciousness, which I think is probably a trend over the last 10 years,
has probably heard that, and the rise of football. Because football and basketball's popularity in the college level are completely different. I mean, people love every aspect of college football, and the regular season has got people hooked week to week. People generally ignore college basketball, maybe not on a campus, but just in America, generally ignore it until right about now, a couple weeks before the tournament, conference tournaments, and then everyone doubles down and watches a good chunk of March. College baseball, it's weirdly timed because it's going on when the regular, I don't know. It's a good question why, considering how many Americans do like baseball, why it hasn't caught on more. I would say in the Sun Belt, et cetera, that not the Sun Belt Conference, but in your Floridas and your, you know, LSUs and Texas and places like that, you get a couple, Mississippi State, it's big. You get a couple thousand people per game, but it's a good question. I don't have a great answer to it, obviously.
Can you tell us your views on walk-on student-athletes?
Pat, you want to start?
Well, you know, when I look back to my time here as a player, I would start there. You know, fortunately here at Northwestern, we have a roster that I think is very manageable. And so to have 110 players on your team allows you to have the opportunity as a walk-on to compete to play. Where some of the larger state institutions have 150-plus players on their team, to be a walk-on is very complicated. You know, are you an active walk-on? Are you an inactive? Do you get to dress? You can't have 150 players in a boundary. There's not enough room. So it goes kind of from, all right, do I get an opportunity to compete to play, or am I just out there for practice, and so on and so forth. For us, it's really been the lifeblood of our program from a backbone standpoint. We've had numerous young men walk onto our program that for this reason or that reason were not offered a scholarship initially, but then earn a scholarship based on their academic achievements while they're here on campus, their ability to get involved in the fabric and the culture of the university, and then obviously they produce on the field. And so it really ends up being a great story, and it's just really of hard work and perseverance, and not saying I wasn't good enough coming out of high school, I'm going to give up and quit playing the game. No, my dream was to play college football. My dream was to go to a school like Northwestern. My dream was to play in the Big Ten. Here we go, I've got the opportunity to do that, and now I'm going to take on that challenge. And then there's that reward at the end. To the great stories of a gentleman like Barry Gardner that I played with here that played for a number of years in the National Football League that was initially a walk-on student athlete to a young man that never played a down of football that we were able to reward a scholarship to for a couple of quarters because he invested 4 years of his life, and that was the least that we can do. Unfortunately, that doesn't happen everywhere where you get brought in, you walk on, and then, you know, at a certain point you go, okay, this isn't worth it. I don't get any benefit from it. I'm a tackling dummy, and then I don't get to dress on the game day. I don't get to be a part of the culture of the team. They put me in a different locker room, you know, so on and so forth. And so it's really a complicated equation for a young person. But at the end of the day, it's about hopefully they're looking at the best degree that they can get, and then hopefully they'll get a chance to earn the opportunity. What a great story it is for a young person to walk onto a program and say, I earned a scholarship at a Big Ten school, or I earned a role, more importantly, in a Big Ten school, and here's what I learned about it, and here's why you should hire me. Because I didn't take no for an answer, I persevered, and this is what you get when you get me, because I was willing to take on that risk.
Over there.
Hey, guys. So, given that ultimately you guys are covering college athletes, 18 to 22, do you take any special considerations when interviewing them, especially when you have a name like SI behind you or the New York Times? And then, Coach, for you, I guess, what do you do to help prepare players for these situations?
Go ahead, New York Times.
I think you, sure, you have to be careful. I guess with a specific situation in mind, it would be easier for me to answer that question, but generally, yes, you take into fact that they're 18 to 22-year-olds, or, you know, if you're even going and covering recruiting stuff, which I do a decent amount, that these kids are still in high school, and you don't try to trap them and do different things like that. And if they stumble their words or look unsure, I'll just be like, it's okay. I'm not going to let, you know, get your thought right before you get it out. Don't stammer around and then worry about what you're going to say and then not be able to complete your thought. So, yeah, certainly it's different than interviewing professional athletes like Rachel does, you know, on a normal basis. But at the same time, you know, depending on the story, certainly, you know, these kids are in position where they've earned scholarships and they're on the Big Ten network and whatever. So it's not all kid glove stuff. I don't want it to be put out that way. But certainly in different situations, you may be a little bit more delicate and just, you know, polite.
I'm definitely in print much more cautious about criticizing a player the way you would. I mean, I don't think I would have any. I don't cover the pros, but I don't think I would have any problem saying, like, you know, Mark Sanchez is having a terrible game. He's a terrible week. You know, I'm much more sensitive about that with a college player. They would have to do something really extreme to kind of just lash out at them the way like a sports talk radio host might do, you know, on WFAN in the morning.
Yeah, I think it starts in recruiting. You know, when you're getting ready to offer a young person an opportunity and a scholarship to your school, and you look on their Twitter account or their Facebook page and you go, I'm not really sure I want to be, you know, associating our program with that picture, you know, that's our job then to call the young man out on it and say, hey, talk to me about the choice of what's going on there. And explain to me now, I'm 37, so I'm 20 years removed from being at a house party in high school. I remember what it was like. It was awesome. Okay, the difference was nobody took any pictures. So why are you letting people take your picture? Choice number one. Why are you there? And what's going on there? And should I anticipate that being your action when you get here? And now here comes the cost-benefit analysis, is do I want that young man here? Because when the things that happened at TCU, I saw it on my Twitter feed, and when I saw the headline, I went, oh no, Coach Patterson's one of my friends. I click on the link, and it says what happened, and there's his picture. Not the however many students, it was his picture. And so I look at it that way. So if it's going to be a young person joining our program, it's representing me and my family, obviously representing the university, because that's what's going to happen if it goes the wrong way. So that impacts my 3-year-old, because he's going to ask me at some point, Daddy, why did that happen? And now I have to educate him. So I look at it from that standpoint. And then when we get guys in the program, unfortunately, every given weekend in the fall, there's some college kid being a knucklehead. I know it's shocking. But somebody's going to do something. You go, let's show that to the guys. Let's not be that guy. Don't be that guy. There's no reason to be that guy. Don't make that choice. Don't put yourself in that situation. And then be a teammate. If you're in that situation, let's get out of there. And that's real hard. That's real hard because their peers on campus are at the party, you know, woo-hoo-hoo, take a picture, woo-hoo, put it on Facebook. They're not accountable. They don't get kicked out of school. But that's the choice you make being a student athlete. And so you're held to a higher standard. Like it or not, that's what you sign up for. And that's part of the expectation. And I agree with Stu. I mean, you're not allowed to be a normal college student. And that set of expectations is not there. So if there's a frat party and there's a fight at a fraternity and it's just a fraternity, maybe it makes a Daily Northwestern, maybe it doesn't. But if it's a football player involved in the frat party, it definitely makes the front page of the Daily Northwestern. That's reality. That's what you sign up for. And that's the expectations that you live in. And if you don't like it, you can choose to withdraw from the scholarship and go be a student and go get in frat fights. And nobody will write about you. But that's what you sign up for. And that's the complicated issue, kind of going back to your first question, with social media right now. And you just can get going on with all the specific incidents. It makes it really tough to make a mistake.
Excellent. Well, I want to thank you guys all for coming and listening to all of us blather on for about an hour and a half. And certainly thank our panel. Thank you, Pat. Thank you, Pete. Thank you, Stu. So thank you, guys.